Father, open the eyes of our hearts to see more of Jesus, we ask. And as we open your word, we do need the help of the Holy Spirit to understand. Jesus said, let those who have eyes to see, see, and let those who have ears to hear. May we have both this morning, we ask, by the power of the Holy Spirit in your wonderful name. Amen. If you'd like to make your way this morning to Acts chapter 4, we will be continuing our walk through the book of Acts. We'll finish chapter 4 today. As you're making your way there, most people here will know that every now and again, I get the opportunity to go fishing. And I want to tell you a story about two fish, if I can, this morning. Two fish are swimming along, minding their evangelical business. And as they're going along, the first fish turns to the second one and says, you know what, let's swim really, really fast, jump all the way out of the water into the air, and let's have a look at the sun as it lays on the sand dunes briefly before we dive back into the water. The second fish says, absolutely, why don't we do that? And as they're preparing themselves, the second fish goes, whoa, hang on. He says, what's the matter? He says, what is water? And this morning, as we begin to unpack what Acts chapter 4 has for us, we live in a culture today that is so saturated in secularism and materialism that I couldn't tell you what secularism is. Today, we live in a culture that couldn't even tell you what sin is. And imagine being a fish for a moment. If you are a fish on the lake where I am fishing, you are in danger. But imagine being a fish for a moment, going about their evangelical business, and all of a sudden they go to have breakfast and they find themselves in a kayak looking at an awfully ugly looking dude thinking, what on earth has just happened? But what has happened is that fish has gone from one world into another. And when Jesus said to Peter, I will make you fishers of men, here's what he was saying. I'm going to empower you to bring people from one world into another world. And today, as we begin to unpack the truth of Acts chapter 4, the truth that comes from the real world, the other world, this world doesn't like that truth. And so before we go any further, we're going to begin our journey looking at the beginning of persecution against the first church. But I want everybody here to know that as we work our way through, Peter and John are the ones that will be questioned. Peter and John are being persecuted, yes, but it's not Peter and John that they hate. The disposition in this world is not with us personally, it's with who it is that we represent. Christianity at large represents an objective truth that many people don't like. In fact, it disrupts them. Going back to fishing, there's an article where they did research on giant trevally in the Seychelles Islands, because what was happening was they were realising we're catching a lot of these fish, but then all of a sudden we can't find them and we don't know where they are. So they put GPS trackers on these giant trevally, and they found that after they caught these fish, they would go completely into another place and never come back. In other words, that completely disrupted them. 2,000 years ago, the God-man stepped into this world and completely disrupted history. Yep. He brought with him an objective truth that disrupts people's hearts. We begin to see persecution, but as we scratch beneath the surface and work our way through this chapter, we will answer a number of questions like, why is it that they hate us? Why is it? What is it that disrupts people about the message? And how is it that we should respond as God's people? You're asking really good questions this morning. John Maxwell says that great people ask great questions. It's clear this room is full of great people. As we begin, let's read the first verses and find out a few home truths for a moment. And as they were speaking to the people, that is, as Peter and John were speaking to the people. The events of last week showed us the miracle of the healing of the lame man on the steps of the temple. And they also, Peter, begins to give an explanation of what's happened. This is not because of me, says Peter. This is not because I'm super holy, says Peter. This is because of the power of Jesus. But the message is about to go a little bit further. And as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees. They're called Sadducees because they're often sad, you see. I promise that's all the dad jokes I've got this morning. Everybody saw that coming before even. You guys are good. You guys are good. And the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them greatly annoyed, or in the Greek, greatly and deeply disturbed. Something has happened and it deeply disturbs the Sadducees. Now, I'm not sure whether we know a lot about the Sadducees, but let's unpack who they are, because as we work our way through the book of Acts, every movement of persecution is instigated and fueled by the Sadducees. Yes, the Pharisees jump on board. Yes, the Pharisees have their own issues. For those that read the Gospel of John and you read the 19th chapter, one of the most saddest and haunting verses is found in the Gospel of John in the 19th chapter, and it says, the high priest Caiaphas says, we have no king but Caesar. He will live to regret those words. But the Sadducees were part of a Sanhedrin, which we'll have a look at in a moment. And the Sadducees were what I would call materialistic rationalists. What do I mean by materialistic rationalists? If you read the Gospels, you'll soon understand that the Sadducees did not believe in resurrection. The Pharisees believed in a final resurrection, but the Sadducees did not. In fact, they challenged Jesus over this and tried to trap him in his words. But they were materialistic rationalists, which means, you know what? They, with their words, they said, we believe in God. They held to the first five books of the Bible because we don't want to understand anything about that prophecy stuff. Because yes, we believe in God, but we believe in a God that we've managed to fashion with our own hands. He's a God that we can control. He's a God that we can manage and we can understand. And there's none of this supernatural business when it comes to God. We can rationally explain everything that happens. No, you can't. The book of Ecclesiastes says, Who can give an explanation for how the spirit comes to the bones in the womb? None. Which is a message to leave the womb alone. But deeply disturbed, the Sadducees are deeply disturbed. Why? Because something very powerful, something very supernatural has happened right on the steps of the temple. And whether they like it or not, they have to stick it in their pipe and smoke it, because they can't get away from the fact that something has happened. And Peter is preaching the resurrection of this Jesus of Nazareth. The Sadducees were highly politically motivated. In fact, they rise to their occasion through a political revolt in the Maccabean times, well before Christ, but they strategically like to politically position themselves. And all of that is under threat. There is a moment in John's Gospel when, just after Lazarus has been raised, the Pharisees and the Sadducees get together and say, what are we going to do about this Jesus? In fact, what are we going to do about Lazarus? Everybody knows Lazarus was dead. Everybody knows what's going on. Everybody knows Jesus is responsible. And here's what they say. They say, if we don't do something about this Jesus, the Romans will come. Here's what they meant. If this upheaval keeps continuing, the Romans will come and take away our position of power and influence. That's how to be in the presence of Jesus and the supernatural and miss it. Completely focused on their own gain. The truth of Christ deeply disturbs people today. In fact, truth has moved from the space of objective in many people's viewing to subjective. What does that mean? Subjective truth sounds like this. If it's true for you, you do you. And how has that worked out throughout history? Subjective truth is, well, that's what I believe. It's true for me. Objective truth is a truth that is imposed on us from the outside. The person of Jesus Christ, the message of the gospel, is objective truth. The message of the gospel is a moment in time when the God-man stepped into our world and deeply disturbed history. They're greatly annoyed. They are deeply disturbed. The challenge that comes to our lives, does your life deeply disturb those around you? My boys would say, yes, Dad. Yours, your life deeply disturbs us. But does your life impose an objective truth in the reality of Christ on others? As we read on, they were greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. You cannot and you will not restrain and lock up God's word. You can't do it. They've tried to do it for centuries. You can't stifle God's word. You can't imprison the Holy Spirit. It will continue to move in power. Verse 5, on the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem. Now we're getting the who's who. With Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas. There's the first blunder. Annas was named as the high priest, but he was deposed in 15 AD. But as an emeritus title, because we don't want to offend dear poor old Annas, we're going to continue to call him the high priest. We also have another high priest, Caiaphas, and scripture clearly outlines one high priest. Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander. We know very little about John and Alexander. And all who were of the high priestly family. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired. Now there is a quote. Now we have God on trial. We have the who's who. We have the Pharisees and the 71 members of the Sanhedrin. Please spare a note for Peter and John. They have only weeks before this event, they have witnessed Jesus before exactly the same people. So if you're expecting justice, you're not going to get it from these guys. In fact, they had sent out a decree, particularly the Pharisees, that said anybody that aligns themselves with Jesus or names the name of Jesus, we're going to throw them out of the temple. Now today, we read that and we think, so what? We'll just go to the church down the road, right? But for these guys, you weren't just throwing them out of the temple. You were throwing them out of a community. In fact, they weren't allowed to trade. It had huge social implications. It had huge commercial implications. You couldn't trade. You couldn't even associate with family. Otherwise, they would be banned as well. And they are standing before these guys and being questioned. God is on trial. We live in an age today when God is on trial. When we live in a culture, particularly in Western culture, that demands God show up and answer our questions. When has that ever worked out? What man thinks they have the right to question God? Job had a lot of questions for God. If you read the book of Job, the first 37 chapters, Job and his three friends had a lot of questions for God. But then God had 69 questions for Job. And he couldn't answer one of them. And here's where God starts. Where were you, Job? Where were you when I formed the mountains and set the parameters of the sea? In other words, who are you to question me? But we find ourselves, and isn't it interesting that God's on trial in front of the religious folk? The prostitutes, the tax collectors, all of those apparent dirty, rotten sinners, they haven't got God on trial. But the religious folk do. It's disturbed them. Everything they've ever known, they ask what power, by what name. They know that something has happened and they want answers. They go on and they say, by what power or what name do you speak? And I love Peter's answer. Peter says, filled with the Holy Spirit, he says to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known. I love this. What I love is that Peter and John are standing before the council and they're not going to allow their audience to determine the truth. We're not going to water this down for you. We know this upsets the Sadducees. We know this upsets the Pharisees. We know you guys are evangelically ticked off, but we don't care. We're not going to change the truth. We're not going to water down the truth. We want you to know categorically that this is because of Jesus Christ. There's a few things that you need to know, that it is by Jesus that this has happened. He's going to go on and say, the same Jesus that you cast aside. The same Jesus that you despised. We need to stop. We might ask ourselves, you know what, persecution comes in many forms. And if you're in Western culture today, I want you to know in Australia, Christians are being marginalised and are being persecuted. And I also want you to know we should not be surprised by that. There are severer waves of persecution depending on what part of the globe you're on. But the reality is there is a push in Western society. We want to push the church into the corner. You can do your little church thing, but you be quiet over there and you only say what we want you to say. We need to stand flat-footed and tell the culture we live in, let it be known that there is a man, a God-man, Jesus Christ. We need to stand firm like Peter does and say, let it be known. We can't change the gospel. We can't water it down to suit anybody or anything else. We have to tell them the truth. Many people might say, well, you know what? We just love everybody. That's great. I'm not saying, but the most loving thing you can do is tell somebody the truth. And it's time for the church to stand flat-footed and say, let it be known that your alternative lifestyles are leading you to destruction. Let it be known. Let it be known that we're not going to change the truth about Jesus. Let it be known that every person falls short of the glory of God. Let it be known that if you are either in Christ or you are under wrath, let it be known that what happens in this world sends echoes into eternity. Let it be known to all of you. Let it be known. What is disruptive here? I love what Peter says. Peter had to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And if we're going to answer, we need to answer truthfully, and we need to answer filled with the Holy Spirit. Let it be known that if we're being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, why are we even having a debate over this? Why are they not dancing in the streets rejoicing alongside of everybody else? Because religion will leave you on the steps of the temple lame. A crippled man, by what means this has happened, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified. That's like a slap in the face with a cold fish. Whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. We're not watering this down. We're not going to change the message here. By him, this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. Now, we might read that and we might think, great, awesome, but what on earth does that mean? Here's what Peter is saying to the religious people. You're trying to build your way to God. This has got echoes of the Tower of Babel. Man has ever been trying to construct their own way to God. Here's what Peter's saying. You guys, you're trying to build your own way to God. You're trying to construct your own way to God, and you're never going to get there because God gave you the cornerstone and you guys have rejected it. You guys have despised him. And in the first century, if you were building a building, the first thing that you would do was you would pick. The cornerstone was always carefully selected. God carefully selected his cornerstone. and you would lay a cornerstone, and from that cornerstone you would take all of your bearings, and every stone after that would be carefully chosen to fit in with the cornerstone. So here's what Peter is saying. Peter is saying, if you're going to build, you need to take all your bearings of Jesus of Nazareth. You need to build in alignment with what he taught and what he represented. But there's a message for us. Is Jesus our cornerstone? I think man overcomplicates this stuff. I think when man gets their hands on stuff, we can overcomplicate it. Jesus made it simple. Every decision you make, every priority in your life, line it up with me. Take your bearings off me. Another slap in the face with a cold fish, but if it didn't stop there, Peter on fire. He's preaching a sermon today. He says, this Jesus of Nazareth whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing here. Well, the stone that you rejected, the cornerstone, verse 12, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. No. Oprah says there's many ways to God. That's because Oprah's deluded and deceived. There is only one way to make your way to God, and that is through Jesus of Nazareth. There is only one place you will find salvation. It is not in a set of rules. It is not in some legalistic political motivations. You won't find it anywhere but in the person of Jesus. And now everything that these guys have ever built, everything that they have constructed, has just fallen down. All of their rules and all of their regulations, out the window. What Peter says is, you are not my highest authority, speaking to the council. Jesus is my highest authority. You guys can't save anybody. Jesus is the only one that can save anybody. It takes boldness. It takes courage. This was likely, and it will cost them their lives. If you want to press the fast forward button on these two guys, Peter is crucified upside down after he gets a little bit of a rollicking on the way. John the Apostle becomes such a thorn in the side of the Roman Emperor that he says, you know what, I'm going to boil him alive in hot oil. And so they put John in a vat of hot oil. And when it has zero effect on John, Nero says, put him on the Isle of Patmos and get him out of my sight. John deeply disturbed. Well, Nero was already deeply disturbed. When I read the accounts of the history of the apostles, they challenge me. When I read about the Apostle John, he challenges me. I mean, he was a guy, nothing held this guy back. Imagine being, it's just like God for the emperor to banish you to Patmos and for you to see the greatest, grandest revelation while you're there, while you're here. Friends, the message has not changed. There is salvation. Some people will say, well, that's Christianity's exclusivity. Absolutely, that's exactly right. Thank you for pointing that out. Yes, it is exclusivity. Yes, we do claim there is only one way that mankind can be saved, and that is through Jesus. But why are you despising that way? It's done. The road has been pushed for you. I remember the first job I had was in the radiator shop, and somebody had done a job on a fairly big excavator, which was a logging piece of machinery, and something small happened, and they asked, could you, you know, it's like $5,000 to get the radiator out and bring it into you. Can you come and fix it on site? So I go there, and the mechanic picks me up, and he takes me out to the forestry, and while I'm working on it, he gets a call from a guy that's down near the creek. He's in this tiger cat machine, and there's no tracks. You just kind of, this machine makes its way through the bush, and the mechanic says, I can't get to you. The mechanic says, I know where you are, but I can't get to you, and I need my ute. There's no roads, no nothing. And if it wasn't by God, a guy in a huge caterpillar dozer gets on the radio and says, I'm coming. And a road was pushed, and the mechanic drove his ute down. Jesus is that bulldozer. The Pharisees are like everybody else standing there going, we're going to make our way to that. We can make our way to God, but you can't make your own way. Jesus came and did it for us. Religion is spelled D-O. Christianity is spelled D-O-N-E. Jesus has done it all. Why would you want to find any other way? I love this. Last week we asked ourselves the question, what was it that Peter had? Because Peter says to the lame beggar, right, gold or silver I do not have, but what I have I give you. Okay, Pete, what have you got? Well, here's what they noticed. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and the words that come next really encourage me every time I read them, and perceive that they were uneducated common men. There's nothing astonishing about Peter and John. These guys haven't been to Bible seminary. When they were uneducated common men, they were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. They were astonished. These guys aren't scared of us. These guys speak with a wisdom that is above ours. It wasn't hard. But they recognised that they had been with Jesus, and so we ask ourselves the question, Peter, what is it that you had? He had the presence of Jesus. I love Mark chapter 3. Mark chapter 3 highlights that Jesus pulls an all-nighter, praying all through the night. Then he goes and chooses his disciples. And it says that after he chooses his disciples, it says that he chose them to be with him. No, Pastor, they were chosen to heal the sick and cast out demons and preach the gospel. Yep. Except before all of that, they were called to be with Jesus. And these guys are standing there looking at Peter and John going, you know what? There's nothing astounding about these guys except we know they've been with Jesus. What Peter had was Jesus. What distinguishes Peter and John is Jesus. What distinguishes us is Jesus. What the world needs is Jesus. The world does not need another formula. The world does not need another set of rules. The world does not need more legislation. It doesn't need fancy lights and awesome buildings. It doesn't need those things. It needs to see Jesus. Peter and his friends in Luke chapter 5, Jesus is teaching and he says to Peter and his friends, throw the nets on the other side. So they go ahead and they throw the nets on the other side and they haul in. Now, Peter precedes this because this is like fishing with my boys. Peter says, we've been fishing all night and we've caught nothing. But they say, you know what, we'll let down the nets. And they haul in a load so large that it begins to sink the boats. That's like fishing with me. And in that moment, there are heaps of people there. But Peter turns to Jesus and says, away from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. He saw something. They're all in the presence of Jesus. But Peter saw Jesus. Often we think, you know what, I want to be closer to God. They had been with Jesus. I want to be closer to God. So often we think we have to do. So, okay, you know what, I'll read more of the word and I'll pray more. All of those things are great. I'll sing more, I'll dance more, I'll do all of these things. I'll express more. We don't have an expression problem, we have a seeing problem. Can I tell you, friends, any heart that sees and beholds the Saviour will fall down in rapturous worship. It will transform your life. Here's what Peter and John would say. There was a day when we went for a walk up a mountain with Jesus and we saw a different Jesus. We went up the mountain and Moses and Elijah was there. Peter names Moses and Elijah. How did he know it was them? Interesting. That's a sermon for another day. But the Jesus that everybody else had seen dropped the veil and they saw him in all of his glory. Peter writes about the Mount of Transfiguration. They saw Jesus. The number one thing I think we all need is to spend time with Jesus. I wrote about this a little bit this morning, that we just need to embrace the quiet life and the contemplative life where we are just still before Jesus. Mary and Martha comes to mind. Martha's busy in the kitchen. And sometimes we think, oh, I need to be busy, when the one thing that is needed is to be seated at the feet of Christ. Verse 14, but seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say. And by their silence, they have said everything. They had nothing to say. The lame man is standing right there. What better testimony than a transformed life standing right there? When God touches somebody, there is nothing anybody can say. That's why we can talk about scientific formula. We can talk about the evidence for God. We can talk about the historical evidence for Christ. And we could talk for a long time on all of those topics. And we can debate all of those things if people want to. But the one thing the world can never take away is the fact that you were lame once, and because of the power that is in Jesus, you are standing spiritually whole because of what he has done. They can't argue with a transformed life. They can't argue with your testimony. That's why at the men's breakfast and so forth, we like to have testimonies about what God has done, because nobody can take that away. Matthew 11 is... You can read this when you get home, but Matthew 11 is very encouraging for me in many respects. Matthew 11 tells us that John sends his disciples to Jesus. That's John the Baptist. John the Baptist that said, "Behold the Lamb of God," is the same John the Baptist that sent his disciples to Jesus and says, "Are you the one, or should we expect another?" Let's stop the bus. You spent ages telling us he is the one. You baptized him. The reason I take encouragement, we probably all have seasons like that. But here's what Jesus said to the disciples. Go back and tell John what you see and what you hear. The blind receive their light, their sight. The deaf hear. The lame walk. The lepers are cleansed. In other words, there's nothing to say. You go and tell John what you've seen and what you've heard. I love this. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying, "What shall we do with these men?" Here's what they're saying. We talk a lot about God at this council, but these guys seem to know him. What are we going to do with these guys? We may be in Acts chapter 4. We may be talking about the Sanhedrin. We may be talking about Pharisees and Sadducees. But we live in a culture today that is asking exactly the same question. What do we do with these Christian folk? How are we going to get rid of them? What are we going to do? How can we ostracize them and push them into the corner? What are we going to do with them? Why? Because they're disrupting our way of life. The Sadducees and the Pharisees do not like what they cannot control. If you're here this morning saying, "You know what, I'm a control freak," welcome to a room full of control freaks. Everybody wants to brush the Christians aside. I love what Peter says. Peter, let's listen to the threats. "What shall we do with these men who perform through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it." Verse 17, "But in order that it may spread no further among the people," wasted time. It spread anyway. "Let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name." So they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered, how should we respond? In a culture that wants to silence us, in a culture that wants to push us aside, how should we respond? I think Peter summed it up very, very wonderfully. Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and what we have heard. You can't shut up the word of God. We can't be silent for what Jesus has done. Jesus has been raised from the dead by the power of God due to a sinless life. We can't be silent. We had breakfast with this guy. We cannot but speak. The more God impacts our hearts, the more our mouths will speak. And as the church, we must respond the same way. We cannot but speak of what God has done for us. We will not be silenced. We will not change our way of life. We will not water down the gospel. I love this. The book of Acts has begun to reshape my prayer life. Many of us sing and pray, and rightly so in some respects, but many of us for a long time have prayed, God, pour out your spirit. My prayer life has changed from God, pour out your spirit, to God, empty me, that I may be filled. And the more I read the book of Acts, and the more that I read the epistles that Paul wrote, I'm astounded at what it was that filled their prayer life. Just imagine what Peter and John have gone through. These guys have locked them up overnight. They have questioned them and poked them and prodded them, all because they did something good. What would our next prayer be? Lord, strike those guys with lightning very conveniently. Maybe our prayer would sound a little bit like this. Oh, Lord, those guys are serious. Can you take away this persecution and silence those that are coming against us? Interestingly enough, that's not what the apostles prayed for. Let's read it. Verse 23. When they were released, they went to their friends. Friends, I love that. They went to their friends and they reported what the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices to God and said, Sovereign Lord. That's a powerful statement. Here's what Sovereign Lord sounds like. God, we know that we are not in control. We know that you're in control, and we are okay with that. Yep. Nobody, Lord, is above you. Sovereignty means you answer to nobody outside of yourself.
I like that.
God doesn't answer to anybody outside of himself. God is the sovereign God. The record of Scripture teaches us he raises every leader and he brings every leader down. He is the one that forms nations. Salvation belongs to the Lord. He is the sovereign Lord. They then go on and speak about how he is the one that created the heavens and the earth. They affirm who he is. They affirm what he has done. And when they pray, they don't pray that this persecution would go away. They don't pray that all the trials would be removed. They don't pray for any of that stuff. They ask for more boldness. Wow. Well, hang on a second. What about your prayer list? Doesn't matter. He's sovereign. I love the words of Corrie ten Boom. Corrie ten Boom says, I start every prayer by thanking and praising God. And she says, by the time I'm finished thanking and praising God for his power and who he is and what he's done, I realise that all my prayers are answered. In other words, I realise he's capable and willing in his sovereignty. What is it that fills our prayer life? It's interesting, you know, Paul writes to churches that are being horrendously persecuted. And he doesn't pray for an ease in the persecution and the trials. He prays that their faith would grow. He prays that they would have a greater sense and awareness of the love of Christ. They pray that through all things that they would grow in their knowledge of Christ. Knowledge in the Bible is not what you put in your head. It's about an interactive communion and intimate fellowship. It's interesting how their prayers were altered and changed. I wonder how our prayer life sometimes sounds. They finish with prayer. This morning, as we bring this to an end, I have three questions for us to reflect on. First question is, Does your life disrupt those around you? I have had many people say to me, and it's encouraging, Pastor, sometimes your messages make me uncomfortable. You're welcome. Can I just be candid and say that the greatest tool in the hands of the enemy is to make us comfortable? The history of the church is that when she is the most intensely persecuted, she thrives and grows in the greatest measures. Are we living in such a way? I love the story of Robert Louis Stevenson. Robert Louis Stevenson was peering out his window when his mum walked in. And in those days, streetlights didn't just automatically come on. Somebody had to go along and light the lamps. And his mum walks in, watching him look out the window, and says, Robert, what are you looking at? He says, I'm watching somebody punching holes in the darkness. What I love about Sundays is we sit in a room full of people that God has determined, I'm going to punch holes in the darkness. When you go to the supermarket, when you go to school, when you go to work, does your life disrupt those around you? Is Jesus your cornerstone? Very easy words to say. But do we take all of our bearings from Jesus? Does he determine our desires? Does he override every other affection in our lives? Do we build our life, and do we build our churches in line with the cornerstone? The last one is, have you been with Jesus? I've used this analogy many times, and I'll use it again. I think it's one of the most profound things that I've ever learned. When I was at the Salvation Army, I've shared this story. We had a retired science teacher by the name of Grant. And I learned more about science in church because of Grant than I ever did at school. And there's other reasons for that. Sorry to all of my teachers if you're watching. I ask for forgiveness. But what I loved about Grant was he would do the children's talks. We used to have children come down the front and he'd do these zany little experiments, science experiments. I enjoyed it more than the kids. But one of the experiments he did, he came down with two nails and a magnet. And he grabbed one nail and he touched another nail and nothing happened. He rubbed the nails together, nothing happened. He allowed them to, nothing happened. Then he took one of the nails, and while he was talking, he just rubbed the nail along the magnet. Ever so slightly, just along the magnet. Then what he did was he took that nail at the end and he touched it on the other nail. And it picked up. The magnetism from the magnet had transferred to the nail. All because the nail had been with the magnet. Our greatest call, our number one priority is be with Jesus. Sit at his feet in his presence and be with Jesus. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you that your word cannot be contained. I thank you that your word cannot be locked up. I thank you that your word cannot be suppressed. I thank you for the truth of Jesus, and we thank you for the wonderful truth of the gospel, and we pray, Lord, that we would live and speak the truth of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation. I pray that you would use us and that you would use this church to disrupt those around us with the objective truth of the person of Jesus Christ. May you use each one of us to punch holes in the darkness. We pray in the glorious name of Jesus.